And welcome everybody to taking the time to be with us and to listen to our story, and hopefully we can also answer some questions. The stickies do still cover the walls. Some fell down, but no one picks them up because the office is empty. Evelyn, the CEO of a big company, sits at her home office desk and she stares out of the windows. At the beginning of 2020, she kicked off a large agile transformation in their organization. They were well on the way. They changed a substantial part of their organization into new agile structures, tribes, squads, circles, squares. They also digitalized a lot of the organization. The office has been totally refurbished and to facilitate the new methodologies, the rituals, and the meetings. And then COVID hit the world. Looking at the empty offices, she wonders, what happened? We were so well on our way. We changed everything. But what are we really doing different? And now in this virtual setting, I have the feeling that I lose control. Like Evelyn, you may have some similar experience. And these experiences are not only because of COVID. We also experienced them already before. And that's where I met Margarita 2 years ago at the Business Agility Conference in London. And we discovered together that we share the same purpose, to promote the importance of the people perspective in every change, in every transformation. And with a backpack of information, of experiences, and of stories, we want to share our story today with you. My name is Alisa Hofmeester, and I want to introduce myself by my purpose. Gather a team, set up the expedition, sail the waves to explore beyond horizons. It's not about discovering new landscapes, but it's about seeing things in a different way. There's a whole story behind this purpose, and I'm not going to burden you with that today. So you may ask some questions afterwards. But the key elements are, for me, that it's about team. And it's about trust. And it's about moving forward and tell the story to share. Finding my purpose made me do totally different things in life and in work, and to get more balance in it, because having a purpose, that is what makes you unique. You as a person, you as an organization. And having this purpose also makes it clear that that you get more focus and that you do the work that really matter and that align with your purpose. And last but not least, yes, it is a bumpy road, but it's also fun. And it gives a lot of energy and flow. And also because of my purpose, I had the courage to change, to take some different steps. After 10 years of working in the agile transformation within ING, I decided to move on and to found my company Twinkster. And with Twinkster, I help other organizations to find their way of working and their way of thinking. And I typically say there, because every organization is unique. So you cannot only copy paste, but it's your way of working. And as part of my purpose, I like to share the stories so we can learn from each other, because we do not know what the future is and we need to learn from each other. And I also wrote down my stories, experiences, but also from other organizations and from other people in the book Purpose-Driven People, Creating Business Agility and Sustainable Growth. So, but thank I'm not you. Only here, I'm here together with Margarita.
Thank you, Alice. Hello from my side as well. I'm very excited to be here today with all of you. My name is Margarita. I'm an Agile Transformation Coach at Erste Group Bank, located currently in Austria. I'm very excited to share this talk with Elise, and Elise knows very well that my deep purpose and passion being an agile transformation coach is to go beyond the obvious agile frameworks and terminologies that surround us. And instead of overwhelming our teams with structures, roles, wordings around agile, I focus on helping our people embrace the change and go on the change journey in a way to better collaborate, innovate, and co-create together. I'm also co-founder of the Agile Hub at Erste Group, which relates to my deep belief in the power of collective intelligence, in the power of building communities bottom up as an energy source for greater business agility. Before we continue, let me also say a few words about my organization, about Erste Group, who we are and what we do. Erste Group is one of the leading financial service providers in the eastern part of the European Union. We are proud to have more than 200 years history, more than 16 million customers and 45,000 employees. We are also very proud to have one of the most modern pan-European banking platforms, our George, with its more than 6 million customers now onboarded in six of our countries of operations. You know, in the banking industry, while we were heavily disrupted and things changed very radically for us, one thing has not changed, and this is banking is about people. We have a very deep purpose to provide prosperity to our people, to our customers, and to help them build their financial health. So with this purpose in mind, with many of our teams, we started a journey towards more modern and agile ways of working in an effort to learn how better to work with each other, also learn how to better work with our customers and provide an even better value proposition for the financial health and prosperity of our customers and as well of our region.
Yeah, transformation, Margarita, what you already said. When we talk about transformations, if they are big or small, that doesn't really matter. But we mostly talk about the visible part of the transformation. So about AI, digitalization, agile frameworks, and so on. But in the journey to new ways of working, there is more going on. And not only in the visible part, but really in the invisible part. And that's what we want to share with you, what our experiences are, and what you can do to also make that change and to really make it a journey with all the people in your organization by using all the human intelligence. How's that for you, Margarita?
Absolutely, I can relate to that because, you know, when we started experimenting in our organization with different agile practices, we very soon realized that this is not just about, you know, putting a few tribes over there and having several scrum teams over here with several product owners to manage all of that. It's really about a deep change in people's beliefs, in people's approach to ways of working. And therefore, you know, for us, it was a lot about, okay, how can we help our people? And this is what we would like to share with you today. I brought a few examples on how we support our teams on this journey and how we also, together with Elise, would like to reflect together on you, with you on the main change principles that for us are critical if we want to really unlock this power of human intelligence.
Going back to Evelyn sitting at her desk, she really sees the benefits of agile transformation. It's about organizational level, on commercial level, workforce related, and also in maybe changing or more better able to change and responding on the changes in COVID. And that's not only her experience. We also see that with other companies. And the latest report of the Business Agility Institute from 2020 also stated that. But the organizations that really feel the benefits, they also see some challenges. And those challenges are related to the people. The way we lead, because in agile organizations, we distribute our leadership. Self-organizing teams they also lead. Mindset, that's also a difficult part, because what is mindset and what do we need to change then? Silos, I thought we solved that problem in the agile transformation. But when we only work in an agile way, in, for example, HR or marketing or other sides, parts of the business, are we really solving the silos? Sponsorship of the board. And Margarita will also share something about that, that it's organizations that really feel sponsorship from the board of the organization, they are better able to make the journey to agility. And the cultural part. But we all live in a kind of bubble. We all have our views. And maybe Evelyn also has their view and their bubble. From research, we know that 98% of the CEOs think that purpose is very well understood. But the lower we come in the organization, employees think different about that. 35% of employees experience a disconnect between purpose and the day-to-day actions. So Evelyn decided to do it different. During 10 years of experience in agile transformations, I found some key elements that are important to really make the journey. And if you read them, then maybe you think, that's not really different as before. But those key elements, the naming is not different, but the way how you approach them is different in agile transformations. Because before we started to move on in our transformations, we talked about reorganizations. We went from one structure to another and we had an A and a B and that's it. But nothing really changed. And these key elements I also discussed with Margarita during our sessions in London. And underneath all those elements, there are some questions. Questions that can help you. It's a kind of business agility scan. Questions that are help you to find out where to start, but also where to move on if you are already in the transformation. Margarita, do you want to highlight some?
For me, three of the elements that we see here on the People Journey Circle are particularly important. And let me start from my experience with communication and awareness. Often when we start with a change journey, it feels like we start from zero. Yeah, we go and tell people, yeah, what we do now, it's not enough. So we need to change and be prepared for the future. This is rather negative or pessimistic way of approaching the whole story. For me, it's much better saying, let's start with now. Let's see what we have. What are the practices and experiences that we already have in place? And how can we leverage those in the future? In this way, people are invited to reflect on, hey, what are our capabilities? What are our experiences? What can we put in our backpack and go on this journey? Much positive way of tackling the whole story. The second very important element for me is the community building, and not just related to the Agile Hub, which I will talk a bit later, but also in relation to inviting people to be part of the future, co-creating together with you the organization that you would like to have, raising their voice, their hand. Don't just cook things behind closed doors in fancy transformation teams and then dump it on the people. The last element, very important, is learning organization for me, in the sense of having experiments, learn how to work with real experiments, grow and learn out of those. But when we experiment and, as we say, try things out, we should not just do it for the sake of trying. We should always think, what is the hypothesis that we are trying to prove here? What is the desired outcome that we are aiming with this learning journey of ours? So those would be for me the main elements here.
Yeah, so let's move on to some real examples, what you also did in the organization.
Excellent.
What you saw in the framework is that in the heart of the organization, in the heart of the framework, there are the people, and the people and the purpose of the organization and purpose of people. Like Yuval Harari already wrote down in Sapiens, A Brief History of Mankind, imagination is human's most unique trait. So use it. But what can you do then if you want to create a purpose? You can ask the people to imagine the future, to create your purpose. Do that in a few steps. Do research first. Who is the target group? For whom are you working? Is that your customer? That your employee? Is there someone else for whom you want to create value? And if you want to create that value, and if you write down something about your purpose, do you check it with your customers? If it's appealing, and if they say, yes, that's really how I look at you and where you can be of value and of meaning. And if that is true, if you have tested it on your target group, then you start to create your purpose. And the best way to do that is by imagination. And I know, Margarita, that you recently did a nice exercise around that. Would you like to share that with us?
A technique which I particularly like and used in my coaching career is the, you know it probably, it's future social media posts, right? Where you invite your teams to imagine themselves in the future, but from the shoes of their customers. And be it LinkedIn, Facebook, or Twitter, doesn't matter where we write our post, it depends on your environment, but invite the people to write a post, future post on LinkedIn, for instance, from the shoes of their customers. For example, this could be the internal customers or the external customers. What do they say about our offer? What do they say about how we make them feel as an organization or as a team who is producing something for them? And it sounds very easy, but it's very difficult to do. First of all, now imagine yourself in the shoes of the customer. And then imagine that you need to go also in the future. So it's two dimensions you need to be careful about. And then, of course, it comes the moment where we need to validate that, right? Because it's just our own thinking otherwise. So invite real customers. What would they want to say about us? How do they reflect on our own thinking? So simple, but very powerful. And it creates very good reflections in the teams around who do we want to be and what do we want to offer and how do we really want to be perceived by our customers. Very, very powerful. I highly recommend it.
And to state that it's really important that you involve all the people, I really want to ask you, what do you see first when you see this picture? What plops up the first thing in your mind? Maybe you can put it in the chat and maybe Jean-Yves, you can maybe highlight a bit of what people see. You're on mute.
I know, as usual. We were lion, zebras, but then the lion, tiger hiding in there, zebras and the lion. Yes, okay.
Yeah.
Lion, AI or lion. Some people lion, see lion. The grass.
Yeah. Grass.
I like it very much. Lion and zebra.
And there's also a small bird.
Yeah, small bird, yes. On the
small bird, yeah, okay. Yeah,
yes,
okay.
People are starting to see it.
Yeah, great. Yeah, if you look a bit longer, then you see, of course, more. But it's very funny that once I was reading in a book, I read that Japanese children do not even see a zebra, a lion, or a bird or grass. They only see material. And so there are also children from other countries who only see the stripes. So that's why it's very important. Everyone has a different worldview. And today, and especially in the virtual world, we are able to work with people from all kinds of cultures and all kinds of backgrounds. And therefore, it's very important that you do not assume that people understand you. People in the team, maybe they think totally different about transparency than you. So it's important to really have the dialogue about that, that if you make team agreements or that you create, for example, behavior profiles in your organization, that you involve the people and that you let them tell what is important and how do you view transparency or hierarchy or other topics you want to show in your organization. Because we do not only want to hear the lion, we also do not only want to hear the bird. Maybe they are the loud majority, but we also want to hear all the zebras and all the people in your organization. Together, we have a lot of ideas and a lot of power and a lot of intelligence. So use it. And this picture, that is always my favorite. I really love to watch the swarm of starlings. And why? Because we can learn a lot of nature. When you have a look at those swarms, and there's a power, there's a flow, there's an energy. And I'm always curious why there is never one starling dropping out of the swarm and falling into the water. But they have some rules, and they are very simple. They follow the same direction. They follow the starlings around them. They follow 7. It's a magic number. It's a Dunbar number. They do not bump. They stay together. And that doesn't mean that in the organization that you do not bump, because yes, of course, we have some conflicts. But conflicts are not a problem. It's a problem if we do not talk about it, if we do not have the dialogue about it. Follow the same direction. That's very important in organizations, that we, when once we have our purpose, that is our direction. But how do we align all the teams and all the people in the organization? What is a very powerful, I know if I say tool, then some people become very angry about me. But we work, for example, with Obeya rooms. And Obeya is not that you put everything on the wall. Yes, you do, because you make everything visible. But it's also a room where you step in, even in the virtual world, where you step in, where you see, where you have an overview. This is our purpose. This is what we decided, what we think are our principles. This is our strategy. These are the values. And this is these are the themes where we think we need to prioritize. And then we can align all the teams to the purpose. So all people in the organization know what they are working on. And what they are working on, that it's meaningful to achieve the purpose and to create value for the customers. And Margarita, how do you do that in your organization?
Another example which I can bring on how to create this direction or frame around which, according to which we fly, so to say, is again very simple. And how about team canvas, team agreement? Now, I challenge you, it's a very simple thing, but let's ask ourselves honestly, how many of our teams in the organization really have a team agreement somewhere, either written down or pictured in Miro, or whatever? Do we really have structured agreement between the team, between the team members, who we are, why are we here, what are we supposed to achieve, how do we work together, how do we communicate, what happens if we have conflict? What happens if we cannot decide? So all of good questions, which we always somehow hope we will figure it out along the way. But from my experience, it's very great to have it first day when you have a new team or when you start a new journey or a new initiative to clarify that with the team members. And of course, reflect on it as you learn and as you experience. I would also like to bring an example around collective intelligence and tell you more about our Agile Hub at Erste Group. We, together with colleagues of mine, we founded this Agile Hub as a community of practice to build and share knowledge on Agile. We just got the momentum in our organization. We had a lot of teams starting to experiment with Agile practices in an effort to improve time to market, collaboration, and innovation. And as a result of that, we started having accumulated learnings and practices that we have in our organization, and also a growing percentage of our population started to be exposed to Agile terminology and experiences, which we didn't understand well enough, and we didn't understand what is really the value. So we decided as a group of enthusiasts and believers in Agile that, hey, we need to take action. We need to raise awareness in our organization about the benefits of Agile way of working, go beyond the buzzword, and really reveal what is the deep value in it. So our activities now are related to creating transparency on all the learnings that we have from experimenting with Agile. We also organize in-house trainings. We support our teams on their change journeys. We have a lot of exchange sessions. For example, we have Agile cafes, which happen twice a month, and they are from our teams to our teams as a platform to really present what we do and what are the experiences. So I really recommend to have such communities in your organizations and really build them bottom up without coordinating them too much and putting on them organizational structures. Let it self-organize, let it be grown by enthusiasts. It really creates a lot of energy. It really creates a lot of enthusiasm, participation, volunteering. We have a huge list of speakers, can you believe that, for our own Agile cafes, from our own people who dare and want to be on stage and share how they experience Agile. So it's a great thing to do. And coming back to sponsorship, what Elise mentioned before, we founded that thanks to also our management, because yes, it's bottom up, but we also received from our managers the belief that we believe in you, and we believe as leadership that you know that this is the right thing to do, and we believe in your enthusiasm. And that was very important for the Agile Hub to be founded and flourish.
Yeah, that's a great example, Margarita, the sponsorship and the belief in other people, people in your organization. So that's also a bit what Evelyn thought. How can we change this? And she started to really change the transformation team, made it multidisciplinary. Not having an approach top down, but really from bottom up, include the people in the organization. And they started because when you change to an agile way of working and you have new self-organizing teams, then you also find some new constraints. They will always pop up, like in the processes. The budgeting, if you move from yearly budgeting and yearly KPIs to, yes, maybe on company level, a yearly OKR, but slice them down in pieces and really see, okay, what do we need to do the next quarter? And then have a retro on that and again prioritize on the work, then a yearly budget maybe becomes a problem. And the same is with staffing. Because maybe if you have a self-organizing team, the self-organizing team wants to have a look at, okay, what kind of people do we need in the organization? And maybe they also want to apply for projects or work in the organization as a whole team and not as an individual. So she started to change the approach. And people in your organization, they really have brilliant ideas. And let's find them themselves.
Absolutely.
How do you approach constraints, Margarita?
Exactly. So now that you gave me this word, we have every month something called Agile Hub Marketplace. And it's a very simple event. Volunteers from our Agile Hub community, they join. Someone has a question, someone has an answer, someone has an idea, someone is looking for an idea. So it's a real like marketplace which is self-organized, not bound to agendas and so on, which allows people to bring the pain points that we face in our way of working and any general wonderings that someone needs help to, which helps us to talk about and openly to talk about constraints, barriers that we face, blockers maybe that we face. And it's also a very nice thing to have and to rely on.
And what I also hear you say, Margarita, and what I also experience is that it's also really about the learning part. Experiment, because we do not know what comes up next. So we need to experiment and learn and improve. And I think you remember that one of the challenges, one of the five challenges, is also about mindset. We talk a lot about you need to change your mindset. We need to change from a fixed to a growth mindset. And we need to let go of old behaviors. Well, I want to give an example from Gianne Dirksen, and she wrote a book for teachers. And unfortunately, it's only in Dutch. But she has an example where she explains very well that we are not able to let go of old behaviors. Because when we start as children to walk, for example, yes, then we start walking, we fall down, we walk, and then all of a sudden we unconsciously walk. We do not even know that we start to walk. So we start with a small goat path. And experimenting and experiencing, this goat path become a road. And then the road becomes a highway. So for example, if you are used to brush your teeth in the morning after or before your breakfast, you have breakfast, and then your dentist says, it's better to do it in another way and to brush your teeth after the breakfast, try doing that. You will find out that it's mostly impossible in the beginning. And that's also what we see in organizations. We need to experiment, but we also need to be able to make failures, because we will fall back always, but we need help from each other. And we need to be able to ask for help. So we need mentors, and we need to have feedback and feed forward, dare to learn. So that's also what you think, Margarita.
When I see the word experiment, I remember a lot of times, you know, people come to me and say, yeah, we want to be more agile. You know, do you have some kind of A to Z playbook which can guide us how to do that? I just, you know, look at my colleagues and say, I don't have an A to Z playbook, but I do have an A to F playbook for you, which can help you tackle the first right points that you need to be successful in the start of your journey. And then again, it's the experiments that we talked about before. Try it, learn, reflect, and define your next steps. So I do have an A to F book, and inside, you know, there are a lot of things like vision, what do you want to achieve? What capabilities do you need? So common sense questions before you go on a journey. And one thing I would also like to raise here regarding experiments is don't just learn from success stories. This is something that in our Agile Hub, we have nowhere stated success stories on our media and intranet. We always call them Agile stories, because it doesn't matter whether it's successful, failure, easy, difficult, whatever. It's important, the experience and the lesson learned. It doesn't matter how it ends for us. So go beyond just the success stories.
Yeah, great, Margarita. Because yes, I know it's important to celebrate our milestones, but also to have a look at the things where we learned from and then share that. So this was also not a success story. It was a story based on our experiences and our expertise. And this is your call to action. Imagine your future, live the values and the principles. Use the collective of the crowd, build the house together, learn, learn, learn.
Yeah, and to conclude, go beyond the tools and really focus on the people, their feelings, their journey, their experience. Ask yourself, do we at the end of this journey want to have implemented Scrum teams? Or do we want to have teams which have healthy collaboration and healthy delivery? That's then your answer, what you're aiming for. So believe in your organization, but also believe in your people and believe in yourself. I would be happy to connect further with you on these topics. Thanks. Elise, over to you.
Thank you. Yeah, experiment and learn and make small steps, step by step, because it's not only for what we do that we are held responsible, but also for what we do not do. Mm-hmm. Let's connect, as Margarita already said, We love to share our experiences, but also hear your experiences and your stories. So thank you.